The Trouble with Old Steam Locomotives, Part 6, The Check Valve, Hand Pump and the New Whistle Valve. I'll start with the check valve. I've removed the pipe from it, and then it's a simple job to unscrew the check valve, take it out of the boiler and have a look at it. A word of caution if you do this though, don't forget if the boiler's full of water, quite a lot of water will exit from the hole where the check valve was. And I do apologise to any viewers whilst watching this who suddenly feel the need to go to the toilet. There are many things in life that I don't understand. I work upstairs in my house most of the time in the studio area and the editing area. The toilet is upstairs in the bathroom. Fairly frequently I go downstairs into the kitchen to make a cup of tea, and as soon as I open the water tap to fill the kettle, I feel a sudden urge to use the toilet, so I go back upstairs into the bathroom and do the necessary. It's very strange, it's all in the mind. I've had medical tests such as a PSA test and all are okay, so it's not that. And oddly enough, if I think about a burning building or the desert and very hot sun, suddenly I don't need to go to the toilet anymore. Very strange. That's enough about my toilet habits, it's time to get back to the job. I'm poking out the residue from the clack valve. As you can see, there's quite a bit of lime scale in here. I'll feature the clack valve in another video because there's something a bit different about this clack valve. Try and contain your excitement, this is not a steam test. I'm putting some water into the water tank so I can check that the hand pump actually does what it's supposed to do. I'm not filling the tank, I'm just putting sufficient water in it so I can test the functionality of the hand pump, because at the moment it doesn't look right. The water outlet from the hand pump is at the bottom and the inlet is at the top, which is entirely different to most of the hand pumps. In this clip I'm taking the pipe off the check valve so I can see what happens when I move the handle. And this is what happens. Surprisingly, water comes out of the pipe, so everything is right with the hand pump. Even though the piping to the valve chest looks wrong, it isn't, it works fine. There's no point in fixing something that isn't broken, so I'm just re-tightening the union nut which holds the pipe to the clack valve on the boiler. And once again, this clack valve or check valve looks like it's made of a metal other than brass, it looks like phosphor bronze. Which is good news, because over time, boiler fittings made from brass, particularly older boiler fittings, can deteriorate. And then they can break very easily, usually when you try to remove them as well. Which can be a bit of a pain, as usually some of the brass is left in the boiler bush, which then needs to be extracted. This engine is a bit of a puzzle. Parts of it are really well made and other parts are not well made at all. In common with quite a lot of model engines that I work on, it's apparent that more than one person possibly built the engine in the first place. I have a 1.5-inch scale Showman's engine, which is a really nice thing. That was built by three people. The first man was an excellent engineer, so was the second one, but not quite as good as the first, and the third person had got no idea at all. I threw away all of the parts made by the third person, and one by one I remade all these parts myself. The traction engine runs beautifully and it's a lovely thing to look at. On the spectacle plate of the engine there's a valve, and this valve is not really doing anything. It's actually a redundant water bypass valve, so I'm removing it, and now I have a nice neat hole in the spectacle plate, which is just the right size to allow me to fit this valve in place. All I have to do first is partially dismantle the valve. Then I modified the valve in the lathe so it has a coned union connection. I did this just by introducing a centre drill into the end that wasn't coned. Here I'm just testing that the coned union fits it okay, and indeed it does. The good design about these valves is that the operating lever can be rotated through 360 degrees so you can position it where you want it. These truly excellent whistle valves are made by Chris English at CME Engineering, and you can buy them from Blackgates Engineering. The next part of the job is to refit the brass plug into the end of the whistle valve. I'm applying some Loctite 542 to the joint so it doesn't leak. I then push this plug through the hole in the spectacle plate. And then, not forgetting to fit the ball and the spring into the main valve, I screw the valve body onto the plug which is through the hole. And after doing that, it looks like this. Sorry for the wobbly camera work, it's not the camera that's wobbling, it's the engine's soft suspension. Normally the whistle would mount directly onto this valve, but if I did that it would be inside the cab, which is not a good idea. That's why I'm fitting this double union into the part of the whistle valve that normally would feed directly to the whistle. This in turn will take a pipe to connect it directly to the whistle, which will be on the outside of the spectacle plate. If I pull the camera back a bit, you can see the general layout. I need to make a piece of pipe that goes from the turret directly to the bottom part of the whistle valve, and then another piece of pipe from the top part of the whistle valve, which will supply the steam to the whistle itself. And that's it for this episode. Thanks for watching, and I hope you found it useful. Please take the time to visit my Mainsteam Models website. Click on the section of the website that says Video Playlists. And by doing that, you will find it very easy to find other videos that you may like to watch.